never trust technology. Spare one there. Thanks a lot for coming. I'm Paul Jones, with that biblio in the School of Information and Library Science and the School of Journalism and Mass Communications. There are a lot of people that helped bring Paul Miller, DJ Spooky, here today. I'm going to read them first, and I'm going to tell you other stuff. We have sponsorship from a large variety of campus organizations, and that, by way, in itself is a way of talking about what Paul Miller and SDG Spooky does. The art department is contributing, the university program in cultural studies, the School of Information and Library Sciences Open Video Project, the Carolina Union Activities Board, Free Culture Carolina, a student group dedicated to free culture and remix culture, and iBiblio.org, which for 15 years has been helping people that want to share information freely and legally share that information. Now that we've done with the sponsors, Paul Miller is a creative person in all ways, as you'll see from his work with music, from video, but also for an interpreting, understanding, and remix culture. To give an example for myself, I first saw Paul Miller in performance in a warehouse in San Francisco at the Creative Commons kickoff when he was beginning Rebirth of a Nation. A couple of years later, my mother-in-law saw him at Spoleto in Charleston do Rebirth of a Nation. And a year and a half after that, my then 13-year-old son and myself saw him do Rebirth of a Nation at Memorial Hall. In between then, he did it at Lincoln Center and a number of other venues. But Paul Miller doesn't stop at just creating culture. He also spreads and distributes cultures, both by ways of his books. This is the merch moment. Rhythm science, which is taught in a couple of courses here at UNC. But you don't have to be in courses to buy it. It's for sale. Right back in the back of the room here with the assistance of the Bull's Head. And for those of you who are patient, Paul Miller is the editor of the forthcoming Sound Unbound from MIT Press, which has a number of great contributors to remix culture writing in it. And if that's not enough, there will be CDs after the show, which you will be encouraged to listen to pass on, and to copy. Pardon me?
Before or after purchase?
There's no purchase involved. But money will be accepted. I'll be right over here. Paul Miller, of course, you've seen him as DJ Spooky. His recent stuff, I've tried to talk about the cultural reach from Warehouse to Lincoln Center. He's also performed at the Venice Biennial. His African remixes are listened worldwide. He's now recording Penguins and Ice in Antarctica. So Spooky has done America, Europe, Africa, and Antarctica so far that I know of, touched all of these bases in a new kind of remix. Tomorrow night at Duke University, which UNC students may purchase at the same discount as Duke, even though we lost the ball game, $5, he'll be doing a piece based on White Stax, when Stax Records went into Whites and did what was known as the Black Woodstock. Tonight, it sold out, but Mavis Staples, who was one of the original performers at that event, will be performing at Duke. So Duke's doing a really neat program of connecting generations and work across time and space, since they are doing it in Durham and not in Whites. Today, Spooky is going to do a talk and lecture, which will be interactive, and at one point later, we're going to bring up two people to speak with him as he speaks to you. Those people are Lanice Williams from the Department of Art, and T.J. Anderson, who I know is a great friend, but also is an avant-garde composer who was for a long time the head of the music department at Tufts, and also a colleague of, among others, Melvin Tolson, who you saw depicted probably in The Great Debaters. So, Paul Miller, and you guys.
First and foremost, I wanted to say thank you guys. I know it's a Friday afternoon, and it's not every day you would come out to see a lecture on Friday, right? But the whole idea here today is to kind of explore some issues that I think are very resonant with contemporary art, but also contemporary music, and the overall idea of cultural production processes right now. So I'm an artist, I'm a writer, I'm a musician. And the funny thing that always tends to linger in my mind is how people tend to compartmentalize things. So a writer's a writer, an artist is over there, a musician's over there. And one of the things that I ended up encountering when I was coming up in the ancient mid-90s is that people really are very firm about the boundaries between the arts. And when I think about hip-hop, when I think about electronic music, when I think about all the different categories that contemporary culture, you know, kind of interacts with, one of the things that really holds it all together is software. So software has really destabilized a lot of the categories people use to divide the arts. So what I'm going to do today is kind of unpack some of the issues I think really drive a lot of the artwork that I'm dealing with, and to hopefully draw you guys into some of the mythology that I use to create my work. So first and foremost, the lecture is kind of, it's not in the club, like, oh, kind of stuff. So this is the art lecture, just as a little heads up. I've tended to find over the years, one of the first things that people kind of think about with DJing is mixes. So a lot of the issues I'm going to deal with in the lecture are about sampling, which to me, at least, I like to call the Photoshop imagination at this point. Everyone is driven by a kind of layered sense of collage, whether you're online, or you're going on websites, or whether you're downloading files and looking at multiple screens at the same time. That sense of disassociation, of always having multiple information coming at you, I think is another kind of underlying theme of a lot of the issues I'm talking about. So we look at this idea of a tension between art and artifact, mix and remix. What ends up happening is you have a conversation between originality and derivative works, which I think, if you look at sampling over the course of the last 20 or 30 years, it's kind of like unplugging some of the issues that drive collective consciousness at this point. So I want to play a little example. I always tend to find examples work. Memory is a strange place. All right. Remember this guy? I hope we've all forgotten him soon. And one of the things that always strikes me whenever I do a talk is people want concrete examples of editing as an art form. So I want to play you a quick example of one of the first people to really think about this. His name's Méliès. He's one of my favorite filmmakers. But he started out as a magician. And so tonight, or today actually, 3 o'clock, I want to kind of take you guys on a little trip back in time to the analog era. And what you're going to see here is one of the first music videos where sampling was used visually. And he makes copies of himself and becomes a one-man band. So just remember, this is from 1900, which is now over 100 years ago. And just think about, the Hey Ya video from Outkast or something, But what we're going to be doing today is playing with fragments of collective memory. So while this is playing, I want to ask if we can pass out these CDs that we have up here. And the idea here is the gift economy, playing with fragments. And the idea, hopefully, is that as you see these fragments on stage, you can kind of think about the way the listening experience is, of course, fragmented itself. So we'll pass these out. If we can get a couple of people, probably that'll make it go quicker. And just take one. The idea is take one and pass it on. So hopefully there'll be enough for everybody. I like to call this the gift economy. So music is made of networks. It's always about certain kinds of exchange. And one of the things I've found over the years is everybody likes different styles of music. But if there's one thing that iPod has done, it's destabilized these categories again. So very few people listen to an album all the way through these days. They listen to one or two selections in the album and move on. So what I wanted to do with this discussion is mirror that with these mixes. So if you open it up and you see you got one with parachutes, that's 40 years of Jamaican music. If you got one that's a dancing joker, that's a lot of my hip-hop remixes and mashups of like Missy Elliott and the Beastie Boys, stuff like that. If you got one with the rabbit with it from Alice in Wonderland, that's a lot of my remixes of classical music. If you got the one with the American flag, that's my remixes of people like Yoko Ono or The Doors. And there's a couple others I can't remember. They're all, but the idea is that everybody leaves here today with something different. So the pun here is not only is the discussion about fragmentation, but the fact that it's a democratization of things. So hopefully that kind of riffs on this whole idea of sampling and collage, and what ends up happening with the gift economy is people trade. So if you got the one that's a Jamaican one and you want to hear classic music, trade with your neighbor. Or if you got the one that's the other, you know, Yoko Ono, and you don't want to hear her yelling, you can trade with somebody else. But the idea of the gift economy is that music is a kind of dematerialized currency. It's an invisible and very nuanced and very elusive currency. So we set up a network of trade. So memory, of course, is always what sampling's about. You play with the familiar. So I want to, like I said before, start with Méliès, which is, this is a film made at the turn of the last century, and think about sampling. I'll explain the process after you see this. Here we go.
En 1900, il y a donc presque 100 ans, Méliès représente ce qu'il était réellement dans la vie, un homme orchestre.
So that he'd keep doing that over a process that became about 8 or 9 copies of himself. So that's the kind of imagination I'm talking about. The beginning of the 20th century, this idea of non-linear editing, of being able to dig into a text, take out fragments of it, and create a sequence. So what ends up happening there is you have editing itself as a filmatic storytelling process. So the editor becomes the storyteller, and you tell stories with fragments of material. But Méliès started out as a magician. And one of my favorite other filmmakers, Orson Welles, was working a little bit later, and he ended up having a very famous piece called War of the Worlds, where he played with this idea of realism by creating a false impression that we were being invaded by Martians, which actually these days people still believe, come think of it, if you go to Area 51. You know. But the funny thing with that was that at that time, film was very new, projection was very avant-garde, and even if people saw a train coming out of the screen, they would get up and run because they felt that the sense of realism at that time was incredibly rich and very detailed. So, for a magician to become a filmmaker, both Méliès and Orson Welles were magicians, which is always really interesting. They wanted to take a magic process and make it become film. But the same thing was going on with sound. Thomas Edison was really pushing the whole idea of recorded media. So you have a very interesting connection between collage and what is going on with visual arts and sonic arts. So I want to update this, so we move from the analog of this one to this gentleman here, and think of the same process, but this is taking a very familiar speech. Let's think of this as magic realism of the everyday. A very familiar speech that's been edited and resequenced, and the words have been cut up, spliced, and remixed. Here we go.
During these last few months, I've been trained by Al-Qaeda, and I'm weak and materialistic. I told our country and I told the world, if it feels good, do it. I hope you will join me in expressing fear and selfishness. We will embrace tyranny and death as a cause and a creed. We can be summed up in one word: evil. Committed to defeating not only the good work of charities, but the values that will bring lasting peace. And we have a great opportunity during this time of war to lead the world towards suicide and murder. Let's roll.
So you get the idea here that editing itself becomes selection of material, and that selection is part of the art form. So what's been going on with the conventional art world over the last century or so is that people are really trying to figure out the role of the found object. But the same thing has been happening in the role of the composer, the same thing has been happening in the role of the author. So behind me you have a very famous photograph by Eddie and Jules Marais from 1915. It's the cover of Scientific American. And what ended up happening with this series of photographs is that he realized what you call stop motion photography. Breaking apart small fragments of movement was something that allowed you to see how the motion of an object would actually unfold. So you can see the, you know, the guy jumping, the camera's clicking at a very fast rate. You can also see the whole issue of someone fencing and so on, but that sense of being able to break apart and make fragments out of everyday life itself was a photographic issue. But what ended up happening was that digital media kind of brought that home to roost for all of us. So say, for example, if I want to just play a quick drum solo. The artist's palette. You know, forget painting and sculpture and so on. But when you look back at the origins of film and cinema and all these recording arts, what ends up happening is the recorded medium itself becomes part of what you end up using to create. So Marcel Duchamp was operating around the same time as this photograph from 1915, and the idea of the found object became revolutionary in the contemporary art world at that time. He put a sink urinal on the wall, for example, or you had the Italian Futurists dealing with the early, or all sorts of movements that were critiquing perspective and also even what the role of a composer was. They say, for example, the Futurists came with this term, the art of noise, for example. So let me skip ahead here. This is me when I was about 2 years old. That's my mom, you know, with the sort of black power afro. So that's, you know, 1972. And when you look back at that time, of course, no internet, or at least a very, very infant, you know, level of internet. My dad was a lawyer for, he was the dean of Howard University's law school, and my family had always grown up in an academic environment. But as a kid, one of the things that I kind of ended up interacting with was my dad's record collection a lot. So I loved the fact that I could listen to Miles Davis, or he was really into a lot of the bebop stuff like Dizzy Gillespie or Charlie Parker. And going through the records at that time wasn't about taking bits and pieces, but actually listening to the whole album, which I very rarely do these days. But that time period, you know, I was 2 years old, and of course I was barely, you know, I had more hair then than I do now. But the pun here is that not only has that kind of sense of community and listening to records over the course of the last 30 years changed, but if you look throughout the entire century, what ends up becoming the crystallized kind of, if people look back at the 20th century, it'll be that views the era of the recording. That's kind of my thing on that. Thomas Edison was really an amazing inventor. He dealt with everything from electricity to looking at how the phonograph could be a recording device. And as a matter of fact, he never really felt that people would want to listen to records. As a matter of fact, he felt that the early phonographs were going to be recorders for business dictation, you know, so you could get rid of your secretary. So when you look at that, you realize flux, solids, ideas of recording, all of that comes from essentially a couple different people who were experimenters at the turn of the last century. So Méliès making magic tricks out of film, Thomas Edison thinking that recording devices would be used for dictation. You realize how radically new the art forms were back then. So what I want you to do is kind of take a trip back and forth in time and look at this as a non-linear process. So what happens when all of history becomes an archival game and you're going through all the bits and pieces of almost any recorded document and being able to create from it? That's what the Creative Commons is about, the shareware mentality versus the Photoshop mentality. We're now in the era of immensely large numbers, where you have everything from a gigabyte, which is a billion, a terabyte, which is a trillion, a petabyte, exabyte, zeta, and so on. The amount of information that humanity makes every year is about 7 petabytes of information. And 1 petabyte, supposedly, if you look at the mathematical amount of information that represents almost more than all the recorded history of every human term written throughout human history. So, but most of the funny thing is that the data we're making nowadays is, you know, cell phones, faxes, satellite transmissions, most of it would be, you know, illegible to the average human. So we're making more information about ourselves than we actually, how should I put it, need. So 7 petabytes of information, that would fill almost every skyscraper in Manhattan with pieces of paper, you know, to the top floor for miles around. And in fact, there supposedly is enough paper to cover the entire planet if you were to kind of think about how much information it would take to actually document that. So we live in the era of large numbers. So DJing is kind of an information filter. It's a search engine for sound. You're looking for bits and pieces. You're looking for how to actually dive into this immense amount of recorded material the last century has generated, and looking to make the kind of an abstract or dematerialized sculpture out of it. So you're a composer of recordings. And the funny thing that represents is you're playing with information as, or music, not as music, but music as information. I want to just play a quick example here. You get to a point where almost all the materials and the way you loop them becomes the art form. So Méliès is connected to that Bush speech, this 1 second edit of just as hit of a, you know, a billiard ball. All of that is about playing with fragments of time. So what I'm finding more and more as I've been dealing with this art form of playing with invisible material is that the people tend to relate to video and film as a kind of a global storytelling machinery at this point. So I started out, I went to Bowdoin College up in Maine, did 2 degrees, one in philosophy, the other in French literature, both totally useless. But hey, I read some good French books, I guess. But I used to get into these debates with my philosophy professor about the idea of what was this critique of, you know, kind of new production forms. And I ended up doing my senior honors thesis on Ludwig Feuerbach. I don't know if anybody's heard, you know, some old German philosopher. But one day we got in a big debate in class about philosophy in an urban context, because Socrates and Plato would stand up on a soapbox in the middle of Athens in the Agora and you know, say, oh, this is my philosophy. So I was like, well, that sounds like KRS-One, right? You know, or, so I ended up bringing a cassette into class of Early Public Enemy, and, you know, saying this could be the contemporary oral equivalent of philosophy, or KRS-One had this album called My Philosophy. And my philosophy professor was like, no, well, that's urban youth culture. And I was like, well, I think Plato and Socrates were pretty urban, you know, back in the... but I love this idea of paradox, of the new form versus old, how we always apply old forms to new, and it's always a paradox because you're always fighting the last war. So what ends up happening is that the new technologies and new media usually take much longer to filter through the culture so that artists and creatives can actually interact with it in a creative way. So I think that process is now accelerated because of digital media. It's about the culture of the copy. And what ends up happening is that with these dematerialized and actually very ethereal recordings, or it's all software. So once it turns the whole art world notion of scarcity on its head. So if you're looking at painting or sculpture and so on, as very, they're market-driven materials that have to be, or you go to a rich person's house and you see one Picasso on the wall, that's what gives it value, scarcity. With digital media, it's the opposite. It's about the culture of dispersion. And again, that's why I passed out these CDs at the beginning, because at the end of the day, it's copies of copies, and the idea of an original work, or derivative or copy work, it really is almost, as a pun here, is immaterial. So what ends up happening is that the artist becomes someone interacting with this floating world of information. Someone who is an engineer is just as much an artist as an artist is, because they're playing with information. So the pun here is that not only is sampling about filtering information and digging through the huge volume of stuff we've generated, but it democratizes taste, because at the end of the day, whether it's YouTube, Wikipedia, MySpace, and so on, most of these kinds of social network sites are based on democratic response to information, whereas the 20th century was based on a top-down model of the, you know, monopolized media, you know, Hearst, or, you know, all the different newspapers that would tell you there's a war in Iraq, and of course there's not a war in Iraq, or whatever. We now have this infinite perspectives of different versions of the same material. So that actually leads us back to the philosophy of, you know, deconstruction or postmodernism or all that stuff that I regretfully learned in college. So after all these debates, I ended up going to New York. I was writing for Art Forum, The Village Voice, and a whole bunch of magazines. And I realized, damn, I'm not making any money doing this writing show. So I ended up throwing rent parties, like Help Paul pay his rent kind of parties. And so I invited a whole bunch of friends of mine who were artists. Everybody would bring material over. And the idea was, the event was a social sculpture. So people would bring materials, bits and pieces. We'd charge $5 at the door, and we'd pay rent for the studio for the month. And so those parties eventually took off as a series of art events. So they were meant to be a reflection of happenings in the 60s, or using multimedia as a kind of party or social environment. But we realized also that there was an art form involved, even putting together the event. So initially, the whole DJ Spooky thing was a sense of humor. I made these stickers because I believe stickers are a kind of art form in their own right, too. I designed the stickers on all the CDs you guys got. But they're the infinite multiple. Like, you can just, you know, make copies of it, and that's the point. By the way, if you didn't get CDs, there's extras up here, don't worry about it. But stickers, the idea of infinite multiple, the urban landscape as a kind of uneasy tension between public versus private space. So graffiti, hip-hop, stickers, they all intervene in public space in a way that's kind of like you don't want a blank surface of a train, you want to tag, you know, your name on it as a logo. So what ended up happening in the late 70s or early 80s was these kinds of art forms were intruding into public space in a way that created hip-hop. So it's a long story to go back through how that evolved, but I'm going to give you a quick soundbite kind of thing of it. It, to me, at least, comes out of this idea of the sound system, which is a Jamaican kind of situation. And hold on, let me just play a quick clip of some of the early sound system stuff. But before I get to that, it's about storytelling. And if you look at the way that the urban landscape has shaped and molded literally almost all aspects of American life, what ends up happening is if you look at Detroit or Chicago or New York, you're drawn to this idea of the grid, you know, 1st Street and 2nd Avenue, 13th Street and 7th Avenue, and so on. So the way jazz and blues evolved out of these kind of rural social networks of the South, once they hit the city, the music becomes more fragmented. So I'm going to play you two examples. One is an early Jamaican sound system, and the other is Fats Waller doing a sound system kind of thing. He was one of the first people to really MC videos. Like he's MCing and playing at the same time. So just think about that compared to Méliès and the way that they both told the story. Here we go. People started what they call sound systems as a way of replacing the band altogether. So what ends up happening is you have the selector, someone who's playing records of a band that people might have heard on the radio. So what ends up happening is that they experience the event itself, not where there's a band playing, but a DJ. So if you go back, what I was showing at the beginning of the discussion was Méliès' film One Man Band, now literally becomes the DJ. So this is an early sound system kind of thing. But if you compare the thread that I'm kind of connecting here, it's that sound and multimedia, video and film, have all been connected mainly through the issue of how do you tell new stories and how does that storytelling process evolve. If there's anything art has shown us, it's that artists usually embrace these technologies in lots of different ways. So here we go. This is a quick sketch of the popularization of sound systems. Here we go.
I am a superstar. whalers were working at couldn't get any airplane. The radio stations were firmly stuck in the colonial era, playing British and American imports. So giant sound systems toured the island, taking the music direct to the people. Recorded in the morning, pressed in the afternoon, and was playing on Coxon's sound system that same night. The Whalers' first record was an instant number one hit.
You can't describe that moment, man. You just, you in your house, you just sound in the morning time, then in the night, without you realizing or thinking about, you know, going to, you know, that it will be on the air. You hear it blasting on the air.
So they recorded that in the afternoon, literally pressed it that that evening, and gave it to a whole bunch of DJs that night. And so literally that was their first big hit, mainly because people had started passing around the dub plates to the other sound systems. And whoever was playing that song actually drew a lot of people to their sound system. So if you ever go to the Caribbean, you'll notice people put these outdoor sound systems, and this is still going on. But what ended up happening is early hip-hop DJs like Kool Herc or Grandmaster Flash are both from the Caribbean, and they brought that style of playing outdoor parties to New York. So what they ended up happening was like what they call sound clashes, where whoever had the best records would win. So nowadays we have MC battles, DJ battles, and so on. But the whole issue is now not only about how people put together the mixes, but how that reflects in the social environment that actually becomes the art form. So is the, to me at least, what ends up becoming really interesting as an artist is that it's so much of it is intangible, and you're not really sure about how the value of an object, or it's, there's no longer an object even related to the process. So let me just play you one other battle kind of thing. Here we go. Yeah, I'm going to play two pieces here, 1 second. And this is one of the first TV hip-hop video battles. They recorded this on a TV show called Graffiti Rock. And I want you to think about, again, I'm playing you stuff from a lot of different time periods. That's just the way we think these days. It's a collision between lots of non-linear processes. But collage, Photoshop layering, editing, Final Cut Pro mentality means you pick and choose and then make the sequence. Here we go. Oops.
Now, there's word out that there's a battle brewing between Run DMC and Special K and Kubo D. So I think I'm just gonna back out. Word.
1, 2, 1, 2. On the mic at this time, the coolest of the cool, they call me Mo D. It's the place to see Jam Master J. 1 for the treble, 2 for the bass. Come on, Jam Master, let's rock the place. I'm a dominator, get my feel. And when it comes to rap, I'm a rapper chill. When it comes to rap, I'm the epitome. The rapper's idol, and my title is Kubo D. They call me Illa, then Illa, the no one chiller. It's not Michael Jackson, and this is not Thriller. 1 death, not the cold dog, and that's the river run the MC. I'm cooler than the gang.
But I'm one of the chosen few. So when you need that flip just to get you through, all you have to do is say Special K.
It ain't another rhyme who's as bad as me. I got a high power voice, I'm the party people's choice. I got so many rhymes, you gotta take it in. Now what, people, I'm so happy, I don't know what to do. Cause I'm an empty river rock, cold down with the coup. Rock from Africa to France and in the Kalamazoo. And in the place that I play, I hear.
Yeah, but I know that when a party is packed, you need a guy to soak you in. And when it reacts, you need a motivator. That means you need me, Special K.
Next act,
cause we'll have Shannon when we get back.
That is pretty funny, right?
Now,
the gazelles he's wearing are very funny. You gotta, you know, funky fresh. So the pun here is not only are we looking at like quotation of style. That was the record that DJ was playing was Billy Squire, you know, a country music guy. He had a song called Big Beat, where they just had two copies of the same record. They're making the record repeat. So what ends up happening is that repetition is a kind of minimalism. So what was going on in New York at the same time is composers like Philip Glass, Steve Reich, and others, John Adams, and so on, were pulling minimalism into classical music out of the sculptural world. But also, if you look at what's happening with hip-hop, like Afrika Bambaataa, Kraftwerk, all of those bands were becoming more and more minimalist as well. So as above, so below. But the pun here is minimalism created a whole reference to global culture, because if you look and listen to people like Steve Reich's compositions or Philip Glass, what it leads you to is outside of this, the European narrative of classical music, to kind of thinking of things in a global context. So the composer then becomes a cipher and a network. This is one of my favorite, interesting, bizarre network people. Regretfully, the font's a little small. This is General George Owen Squire. Anybody ever heard of him? No. He was head of the U.S. military's telegraph systems during World War I. And what ended up happening is he bought that same idea back to the U.S. after the war. And they felt that if they wired up all the federal offices, people to play music, that the workers would become more efficient. So they actually incorporated his stuff in playing at factories and federal offices. So he owned the Kodak company as well. So he said, you know, this style of networked music, of playing music over wires, would be called music plus Kodak, or sound capturing a spatial image, Muzak. So background music and the idea of courting and creating an environment where people are more productive or more socially oriented towards work process. What ends up happening is that Muzak became a multi-billion dollar corporation. It's a subtle cycle, you know, condition. In fact, most malls subscribe to it. There's music that encourages you to go shopping, for example, if you're in a room. They have, you know, all sorts of, the U.S. military uses this kind of research. They played heavy metal when they captured Noriega to drive him out of his building. Supposedly they're working on microwave arrays in Iraq now to beam a wall with sound, and it goes through the wall and makes people feel like they're being microwaved. But they're testing lots of stuff in Iraq. But to make a long story short, the idea of music and networks. Previously, like I said before, the network was about social transaction, passing records around, mixes, cassettes, 8-tracks. But once it gets, you know, back and forth, because I think the internet's catching up with some of the issues he was dealing with this idea of music, is that you now have the downloadable file. Which leads me to Robert Rauschenberg. He's one of my favorite sculptors and painters because a lot of his work was what they call combined sculptures. He really championed this idea of collage and physical forms. But at the same time that's going on, you have to realize what ends up happening is that, again, the parallel between painting and sculpture and the recorded arts almost moved hand in hand. While he was doing that, composers like John Cage or Steve Reich were also working in this kind of tape cut-up techniques. The sound system situation was going on around the same time. If you look at, you know, that's 1955 and 1960. The idea here is that the Jamaican thing, at least, was more of a third world response to a culture of recordings. So I'm going to play with this idea of found objects, whether it be sculpture, records, or for that matter, social networks. That's a little bit blurry, but this is a really interesting map of the social network of collaborations between the top 55 rappers. This is an MIT graduate student who did a series of research to show which artists did guest appearances on each other's albums, and then made a mathematical model out of it. It's new hip-hop. I'm going to skip ahead. A couple of my projects right now are focusing on Birth of a Nation. It's a very infamous film, you know, D.W. Griffith, KKK, all that good stuff. The funny part about that film is it's the first film to play in the White House, and it was considered a true story. So when I was coming up with the score for it, I did a series of practice runs where I worked with a 76-piece orchestra, where I was sampling the orchestra live. That's me with the computers in the middle, and the orchestra's playing, but then I had them walk off stage, and you couldn't tell what if it was the computers or the orchestra's playing. Sigmund Freud liked to call that the unheimlich, or the uncanny. And of course, I like to just call it spooky. But when you have this eerie sense of a recording taking the role of a living object or person, when I say living, it could be, you know, the recording of a tree versus the actual tree. We're now in a world where the recording represents far more meaning, actually, than a lot of the quote-unquote realist representations of moving through spaces or downloading files and so on. So realism becomes under critique with this kind of stuff. And this is the music that's sort of a mirror to the social reality. One of my favorite composers, John Cage, was the first composer to really make music for turntables. He had a great piece called Invisible Landscape. And it was written in 1939, and the audience got really mad because they walked in and it was just a whole bunch of record players on the stage. Which, of course, nowadays we'd be like, yo, that's a bumping club, you know. But in 1939, the audience had paid their money and really wanted to see a live group. So he said, well, it's an orchestra of turntables. And that wasn't very popular at the time. All right. I've had Rebirth of a Nation touring and traveling. We even got the Greek government to let us have it at the Acropolis. So I sent this JPEG to my philosophy professor. And the amusing thing, hold on, let me just show, it's scale is always a fun thing. Hold on, let me see, where's the Acropolis? Yeah, here we go. Almost loading. So we got the Herodian Theater at the Acropolis, which is one of the oldest and most revered relics of Herodian Greek kind of culture. But what's also amusing about it is that it was specifically for theater. And it's amazing because you can actually hear someone's voice whisper. The acoustics of the space and the architecture of the space are for this, you know, fine art of theater, but I wanted to tell a story in a film. So Birth of a Nation is a very controversial film. And the Greek government was like, why does he want to play a Ku Klux Klan film at the Acropolis? And I was like, hey, you guys are Greek, you know, you have comedy, tragedy, right? And then they're like, oh, we get it. Right. So that's one of my favorite kind of, it's like, yo. And the funny thing about playing, you know, a speaker, you know, we had to put speakers throughout the ruins. I don't know if you can see these are about 20 foot high. That's a person, by the way, for scale. The theater held about 5,000 people. And we put bass woofers throughout the ruins, which was really kind of cool. It was a weird full moon in Athens on a summer night. About 5,000 people came to the show. And I walked out and said, hi, everyone. I think I'm the first DJ to play here in 3,000 years. Thanks for coming to the show. But the whole issue of how you look at this collision between different time periods and representation of storytelling, I think you can just see this in my circle. We still use this logo for movie theaters now, which is kind of funny if you ever see the logo for early movies. We now, of course, have to include the 5.1 bass woofers everywhere. So with Birth of a Nation, you had a crisis of realism in American imagination. The film was portrayed as real. It was used as propaganda to recruit for the Ku Klux Klan. And it was the first film to really strike this idea of pop culture as a huge motherload of money and, of course, cultural influence. So they even invented the term blockbuster about the film because so many people would line up around the block to see it. So I want to just play you a quick kind of excerpt of the film just to give you an idea. And what's going on here is you're looking at something that essentially puts you from the viewpoint of realism, like through sampling. And of course, nonlinear is the way we go here, but you have to imagine that storytelling is about the art form of nuance. And what ended up happening with Birth of a Nation is that it was viewed as real. And again, going back to 1915, that's the same as I was showing you earlier on this the Scientific American cover or the various clips, was that you have to imagine realism at that time was very much about portraying the already known. So racial issues, the way people responded to stories and so on, that was something that was under critique, not only in film, but realism itself, whether it was cubism or futurism or all of these kinds of stuff going on. People were pulling apart the idea of representation. You know? So let me just play this, and this is a quick example, and here we go.
Yes. He made the birth of a nation.
Now I'll ask you a question.
Fire ahead.
When you made the birth of a nation, you feel as though it were true?
The Klan at that time was needed to serve your purpose. Yes, I think it's true.
President Woodrow Wilson, the 28th President of the United States, the son of Confederate sympathizers, struggles with an escalating war in Europe. A woman's right to vote. And a country still recovering from a devastating civil war. While in the throes of his attempt to create the League of Nations in 1915, Woodrow Wilson saw a very different vision of the internal political situation in America than he did with his international idealism. The League of Nations was an attempt to foster what he called an organization to end all wars. To premiere his vision, he invited his close friend and fellow Confederate son, D.W. Griffith, to screen The Birth of a Nation at the White House, making it the first film to play there in American history. The Birth of a Nation set the tone for how film portrayed history. It still fuels the debate about how much progress has or hasn't occurred, its impact on society, and whether such a film should have ever been made. In modern 21st century America, a world of red states and blue states, The Birth of a Nation hangs as a specter over the political process. Ultimately, The Birth of a Nation is about conflict. It shows us controversy and a deep ignorance of history in the form of a film once described by Woodrow Wilson as writing history with lightning. It was something in the tradition of America's first pop culture phenomenon, the minstrel show, showing multiple ideas about American identity, and set the tone for the 21st century's revisionist landscape. Media and the absence or presence of a story in that media could set up a war, or could literally create a vision of democracy rising in the deserts of another foreign-occupied nation. The Rebirth of a Nation looks at Griffith's vision of America tied together with never-before-seen close-ups and innovative techniques, and turns them on themselves to make a film from the viewpoint of DJ culture. The turntable moves to become the projector. The projector becomes the multimedia file. And all of those things look back through history as a digital media where stories can be made as we go. The Rebirth of a Nation is a DJ mix applied to cinema. It's been said that those who don't learn from history are doomed to repeat it. But what happens if we break the cycle?
Have they Pontius Pilate said the truth? What is the truth?
All right, so I found these really rare recordings of Griffith saying, truth, what is the truth? But when you look back at the last century, Birth of a Nation really influenced a tremendous amount of the way people told stories. Say, for example, one of the most famous scenes that's sampled from Birth of a Nation was in Apocalypse Now, for example, which is one of my favorite films. Coppola wanted to invoke the ride of the Klansman. It's a very famous scene at the end of the movie. The whole score for the film was done by Wagner, or they used Wagner's material in the beginning. So what he did was have these U.S. Army helicopters flying with loudspeakers hanging out playing Wagner's Flight of the Valkyries before they blow up all these Vietnamese villages. Or George Lucas always says he's influenced by Birth of a Nation's battle scenes, because if at that time, the film set was over 10 miles long, which was one of the biggest film sets of that time period. And so they had huge battle scenes, and so that influenced Lucas's idea of Star Wars and having all these battleships and like people running around in like big, you know, huge battles. The list goes on. And Griffith also invented the close-up, for example, and the idea of multiple story threads going on at the same time, which leads us to a non-linear kind of storytelling. So, at the end of the day, most of my work is about this deconstructive or archivist impulse, looking at history as a huge archive and as a palette for creating new material. So, tomorrow what I'm going to be doing is going through a whole bunch of my records of Stax records. And this is going to be one of the last examples, because I want to bombard you all with examples, but that's what sampling is about, so, you know. Let's see, I'm waiting a lot, it's loaded. I'm going to play, while it's loading, a quick example of a little bit of a copyright thing, considering we're here. This is a guy named Joe Recker, and at one point he sang the lyrics to How to Decode a DVD, and made a mix of it, and a couple days later the FBI stormed his studio and he was taken away to jail, and they confiscated all his hard drives because the U.S. considers encryption a weapon. So the copyright implications of singing the lyrics to How to Decode a DVD versus the actual terrorist, he was considered a terrorist, which is amazing. But let me just play you a quick example so you can hear.
It takes two arts. The first is SEC, a pointer to a vector of 2048 unsigned bytes that are in the encrypted disk sector and will need to be encrypted. The second is key, a vector of such unsigned bytes that encrypt the title key. The local variables T1 through T6 are unsigned bits.
It's a little math rock. You know. So the sense of humor, of course, is that he did it as a joke and didn't think anything serious. But when the FBI stormed his home and confiscated his computers, by then a lot of people had copied the lyrics down and were using it to decode DVDs. But they also made stickers out of it, T-shirts. I can't remember some other really. Somebody got a tattoo on their butt or something. But basically, it's a sense of humor about the way information spreads and the way music moves through networks. So what ended up happening is that by the time they really tried to lock down on them, all the stuff was completely distributed over the net, and people hadn't really taken it even beyond just a basic sense of humor. And if you're going to decode a DVD anyway, you're going to do it regardless of whether you hear a song about it or not. So the pun here is that a lot of the stuff I'm showing you is illegal. It's going to take a second to load. While it's loading. Yeah, you gotta love that one. Alright, here we go.
Courage and determination. I am
So I'm going to wrap up with that, and I guess
Did you want, Paul, do you want to moderate, or are we going to do the discussion, or?
We're going to discuss.
Okay.
We'll let you guys speak to it. We have some questions.
All right, and one tiny thing, if you didn't get CDs, definitely, please, they're free. I kept them up here. And there's the book in the back, or something. So, thank you.
Got this one? Okay. Whole reason I wore black was so I could change the stage. So I could be the stage prop. Lanice Williams and TJ Anderson and Paul Miller. I thought I'd give each of these guys a chance to respond and then we'll take the microphone up to you guys.
I asked Professor Williams, could I go first? first I want to say what's happened here today. What you may not realize is that you have just seen a presentation of a genius. And what he has presented to you is the future of the arts in many ways. If you think of artists as persons that create singularly, you're missing the whole point. What you have is a cultural anthropologist that documents the culture. And by fusion, he brings all of these things together in a presentation which appeals to your sensitivities so that the whole future of art is on an axis that's shifting tremendously. I heard a lecture yesterday by Professor Terry Smith at the National Humanities Center. And he is the leading authority in the world on the definition of contemporary art. And what he demonstrated there was that the concept of modernity or modern is dead, and that the future of art is actually the future of contemporary, the word contemporary. And what he showed was art from all over the world that fit his definition of what's futuristic or what the future art is in terms of globalization. Now, the art that he presented was art from museums, Aborigines art, art from Africa, art from Asia, art from all over the world with this sense of definition of what globalization means. And the future is clearly presented in this presentation that you heard. I think you're indeed fortunate to have heard this lecture because it gives you a context of where the world is going. And if you're not thinking in terms of the future, I would say you're in trouble in terms of globalization and its effect on your life. I mean, the immediate effect right now is that we're lacking water. I mean, a lot of people want to ignore some things that are happening all about them and the relationship of what the environment is to what they do every day. So I'm saying that I feel very fortunate that we have this marvelous artist here, this cultural anthropologist, and I wonder, I don't have any questions. I'll leave the questions to Professor Williams. But I'm very proud of what you do, particularly in terms of the African-American perspective, in terms of historical scope. And I think that's one of the things, that it's a thread that goes throughout all of your works, and I think it's very important for all people to understand that. And in closing, I would like to say that I heard Fats Waller. I'm not one of those that got got the joy of jumping on the record. I heard him at the Howard Theater when I was a teenager, so I've heard Fats Waller. And I think that your use of the historical context of a culture that's really the vibrant culture of the United States, I think is marvelous. Now I'll pass it on to my colleague.
I know that in my own work, in a lot of my classes, I spend a lot of time trying to think about the stories that we don't hear, the stories that are lying beneath and, you know, in the cracks of the stories that are actually presented. So I know that in your work, Paul, you also spend a lot of time looking at and trying to pull out the stories that are existing between mediums, between different moments, and between geographic places. I wonder if you could talk more about what the types of stories that you're looking for and the ways in which you're looking to connect them in the future.
Well, the whole idea for me was that sampling in the 90s really revealed what I like to think was pan-humanism. And that meant cultures could exchange. They could, you know, you have a kid in Finland listening to something from Brazil, you have somebody in Brazil listening to, I don't know, something from Angola. But that sense of globalization in sound really is something I found to be very interesting and surprising. Like, I go to Japan and they have a Japanese dance hall reggae or something, you know, like really hybrid and also very versatile approach, which is something that theoretician Edward Bisson liked to call creolization, which is essentially how languages migrate between cultures. And one could think of black culture as kind of America's operating system. And I say that, you know, it's not like Microsoft, don't think of that word. But just sense of humor of like how deeply entrenched most people's reference points for pop culture are based in this kind of vernacular from the South to the North and then back again, if you think about the echo chamber. But that discourse has gone on now in the Caribbean and all over Asia, Africa, everywhere. It's really, I think at least transformed the human kind of condition of thinking about entertainment. So in the mid-90s, I traveled a lot, and I still travel a lot, but I kept seeing hip-hop and electronic music and techno, all these styles have really just reached out and changed a lot of other cultures. And you have to imagine, I think, this is the first time, I think, in human history where so many cultures have been in collision. Whether it's, you know, so the whole idea of black, white, that the American kind of thing had been based on throughout most of the last century is, I think, at least dissolving as a paradigm. You're looking at a lot more nuanced reflections of what blackness is about or whiteness. I have many friends from Europe, for example, when they come to the U.S., they're, you know, they're German or Swedish or French and so on, but after a while being in the U.S., they're white, you know, or something like that. It's just kind of, it's a very artificial construct. Same thing with, you know, black culture is not just, you know, with a capital B. You have Nigerians, Ghanaians, Trinidadians, I don't know. So people are beginning to realize you have much more complex nuance of how ethnicity applies to creative process, which I celebrate. In fact, I think we need to encourage more complexity and think about things not in this kind of, you know, very narrow idea of the America of the 50s or 60s. So sampling really pulls that rug from under all that kind of totalizing kind of concepts, because when I go to Africa, you know, country music's really popular, for example. Like, or when I was in Luanda, Angola, there was like about 30,000 plus Chinese in downtown Luanda. Now, that doesn't mean migration patterns are going to all of a sudden make everyone be at peace and singing Kumbaya. You know? But it does mean that you have radically shifted communication patterns and cultural exchange, which to me is always a healthy thing.
If you could talk about rap as only a small part of your musical genre. I know that the early stages was very progressive and deteriorated once it became popular. I also know that it is a part of when we took music out of the public schools and the students were basically left to their own ingenuity, so it reduced music to just rhythm and pulsation, you know, as opposed to melody, song, things of that nature. So if you could talk about that and its relationship to the other things that are involved in the music, I mean, in terms of classical and say country music, all the things that engulf your musical palette.
Well, there's a very funny, I got this one, the funny thing with I really look at a transition point in American culture with the Beats, you know, Allen Ginsberg, William S. Burroughs, Jack Kerouac, Amir Baraka, there's a whole group of them, but the way that they played with language really broke the previous convention. And of course, the Beats, you know, for me are Beats of hip-hop and electronic music. So, the way that ends up happening is that, same example, I remixed, I did a collaboration with Amir Baraka a while ago. He did this piece called Black Dot on Neolismus. And, you know, it was one of the first questions he asked, which is parallel. He was like, Paul, you know, is hip-hop stuff, why is it always repeating? You know, which is, you know, it's a valid question. You know. And I always am kind of a fan of this idea of looking at music as a kind of a reflection. It's a mirror you hold to society. It's not divorced from society. It's not floating in outer space. It's really a true reflection of values, mores, and nuances. So some people can say that, you know, a lot of hip-hop, whether you listen to 50 Cent or, you know, radically different, you know, music like Outkast or Mos Def or Dr. Dre, the thing that links them all is that repetition. And now each of them is going to tell a different story using repetition as their kind of architecture. But what, I don't know, it's a very nuanced question, because why did repetition become the late 20th century's vocabulary? There's a lot of issues with that, whether you listen to classical music or a lot of jazz had moved out of the bebop phase into the electronic kind of, you know, Herbie Hancock, all that kind of stuff in the 70s and 80s. And Herbie Hancock was one of the favorite early records that a lot of DJs would play. You know, Rocket, that was the big jazz piece, electronic. Kraftwerk, for example, Afrika Bambaataa was playing, you know, Planet Rock, which was a riff on Kraftwerk. But minimalism, I think, at least, allowed people to look at storytelling as a new kind of recording process, and that allows them to put their own voice in that structure. Because if the music's changing a lot and like going crazy like bebop, I think it confuses people, maybe, and the way that sound functions in an urban context is people, when they go to a performance, they're there for the theater. And with hip-hop, it's all about sampling as theater. Same thing with techno, for example. There's a very famous inventor, African-American inventor, Garrett A. Morgan. Have you guys ever heard of Garrett A. Morgan? No? Well, one, two, three. He was on his way home in like 1921, 1922, I can't remember the exact date, and he saw a Model T Ford car hit a horse carriage in the middle of an intersection. This is one of my favorite stories, but he said, why are the streets unregulated? And let me, actually, just a one tiny thing. Let's see if I got a photo of this. And you gotta remember, movement in the streets of early American cities was unregulated. So people basically would just walk around. Yeah, there we go. So the streetlight, he went home and invented what we call the streetlight. So that's red, yellow, and green. You know, start, stop, slow down. And that's now on every street corner of every city on the planet. So you have to think of movement in the city as a kind of choreography. You know, you move, you stop, you wait for the other people to move around you. But that's kind of looking at the city itself as a large dance or some sort. But that's a very American model, the grid, you know. But if you go to Japan, you go to Venice, you go to any major city, the streetlight regulates movement. And I think hip-hop comes out of that urban... I'm not quite sure how to define it. I still haven't personally thought through all the way, but that regulated movement and that kind of sense of pause and start and stop, that didn't exist prior to this invention in a way that you were in a city and the city was stopped, you know, moving, and people would then pass, you know, that regulated flow. And I think electronic music mirrors that kind of pulse of steady state rhythm and repetition of, you know, just to start, you know, red, yellow, green, start, stop, go.
Well, I wanted to respond to both of those. When I think of that driving beat in hip hop, I think of, if you think about James Brown and the fact that underneath James Brown was that same driving beat, it was sort of already in place. But then also when I think of James Brown and that driving beat, I think about endurance and durability and, you know, James Brown trying to outlast everybody on the stage and coming back with the cape. But it talks about, you know, just a persistence, up against the wall persistence. And if you think about the beat in that way, and you think about cities and people trying to exist in that space, then it becomes a different kind of descriptor.
Of course, the beat also existed in Miles Davis, when Miles Davis made Bitches Brew. He said, if you can put me in a good rhythm section and I can do anything above it, then it'll work, you know. So that the sense of rhythm is really a part of our African tradition. And the sense of repetition is part of our African tradition, too. So that all of these things come together. There are African festivals that last for 2 or 3 days, and a lot of it involved repetition. And what happens is that the participants begin to celebrate And in the celebration, they go on and on and on, and eventually they fall out. they have exercised themselves so that this is not just a part of the African tradition, it's a part of the world tradition in terms of music and rhythm and its function within the society.
But it, just like what you both were saying, what's so beautiful about that is whether you go to India and you see someone playing sitar, or so you go to the drum festival, and taiko drumming in Japan is incredibly traditional, or you go to China where they have these emperor's drums, and people, you know, the emperor used to have these drum ceremonies or something. Every culture usually had some kind of storytelling that had a musical accompaniment. We know that's a pan-human issue. But what makes America different, I think at least, is the collision between European aesthetics and African aesthetics. So it's hard to define an entire continent, but what ends up happening, if you look at Europe over the last several centuries, the folk tradition became divorced from high culture, and a lot of high culture was then about individual creativity versus the artisan. So the artisan was someone who was a folk anonymous singer, or someone that you would just know the tune or the ballad, and that was a community song, or like, you know, the sailors would go and sing at a bar, and everybody knew the lyrics to the song. But Bach or Beethoven would go and take that sailor song and make a symphony, and that they get to stamp their name on it. This is Bach, or this is Beethoven. So that made it much more individuated. Whereas folk music is where everyone knows a song, so that's they're sampling from a tradition rather than from an individual. So folk music is usually an open source kind of system where people come up with songs, they'll trade them, people learn the lyrics, they'll make their own variations. So folk music in Europe is probably much more similar actually to Africa, because they still had folk tradition, but over the course of the last several centuries, I think at least, I mean, I'm happy to argue with this, but the idea of the fine artist or the life of one person determining an entire style really became foregrounded. Like the idea of the rock star, or the, you know, there's a really good book called Love in Western Europe, I forget the author's name. He said romantic love didn't exist before the troubadour. Because, you know, people had, you know, they had arranged marriages, your marriage was like a tactical maneuver between families or something. So the idea of individuals deciding they wanted to make their own decision, for example. You know, that's a heavy statement against culture. Most cultures had arranged marriage, and the individual was assumed a lot more. And then the idea of the individual in Europe, that's the whole Sartrean existential crisis of the individual. Jazz is kind of a really interesting, I mean, there's some great Jean-Paul Sartre essays about that that I was reading a couple of years ago, but Amiri Baraka with the concept of the changing same, you know. So when you think about it, it's, the repetition is fractured, it's not always the same, it's changing with subtle variations, small like drops in the rhythm, breakage, you know, the break beat, broken rhythms, these kind of things come home to roost, but rock somehow became, I think, the channel for a whole thing of like appropriation of black culture, but in a healthy way, it helped maybe the 60s generation really channel, you know, the breakage point of all this other stuff.
I think we ought to open it up to the questions from the audience now. We have a microphone in front, so those of you that
have that.
Oh, it's recording. Okay.
Guys. Okay.
Questions?
There's one on the front row. Here.
Yes.
Hi. You mentioned that history was a series of repeating the same struggle for the same war. And you also mentioned that you believed in open source culture because it allowed us to constantly update. I wonder where you would see any space or how you describe the present. Separated from the future, updating, I guess, the past struggling against the same world?
Well, that's a good question. Well, recording, the whole idea of non-linear, you know, if you look at an avid film editing system, or if you look at, you know, software like Pro Tools or Sonar and stuff, the idea of non-linear editing really is how most people put together movies, how they put together songs nowadays, or taking bits and pieces, but it's also how people put together history in the past. Like, half of the Greek, the main Greek writers were illiterate, actually. Most of the stories that you hear are word of mouth, where people made variations of the story, might have added a little chapter here or there. But when it got written down, it was supposed to be all of a sudden fixed. You know, or if you look at, you know, Jewish culture is called people of the book, because they're supposed to very specifically, you know, the Talmud and all the different relationships in that. same, I mean, most cultures have some kind of text, you know, even the Rig Vedas in India, or, but it's all stories. We don't really know if it's true or not. You just kind of believe because, well, that's belief. With sampling, all of a sudden you have this idea of text as an unstable reference to history. It's a floating reference. That's a whole deconstruction. Derrida meets Roland Barthes meets Jean Baudrillard, kind of hyper or whatever. At the same time that's going on, history has, if we've seen in the last several years, like the war in Iraq, people tend to figure, oh yeah, where were those weapons of mass destruction? Or why are we fighting this war? Anyone remember? And the weird part of the war, the way the media was able to play a kind of mass cultural amnesia, to me always really is interesting, because I think Bush assigned like almost $500 billion to the war for his last year in office. Like, where's all that money, you know? What about New Orleans? Or, you know, people already forgot about Katrina. So America is a culture of amnesia in a certain way, like memory is a scarce resource. And the media, the way that these things are going now, it's like one of my favorite science fiction writers has a great phrase where he says, the future is already here, it's just unevenly distributed. Which means that there's lots of weird time zones going on at the same time, which is kind of how I feel right now. It's just like, yeah, Bush is kind of, he's like America, like 1850 maybe. You know, then the war in Iraq is kind of a neo-colonial war. It's like, occupy, you know, take the oil, you know, basic obvious colonial kind of stuff, which is like a good old 1870 maybe, you know, British Opium War, you know, just invade. And then all the financial stuff is, that's actually pretty current, maybe 1990. But yeah, it's just all this stuff is going on simultaneously, and it doesn't really, almost, you realize somebody's got a cell phone riding a camel calling in like missile strikes in the World Trade Center. And like, you know, like, and they still haven't been able to find Bin Laden, you know. So that's still like circa 2001. So the weird part about all that is that it's, these are all just fragments of stories. And history, if you look at Herodotus, I always mispronounce it, Herodotus, or the early Greek storytellers that everyone knows have to study, or even Shakespeare, you know, people, those were meant to be oral texts, and the idea of a story changing was okay, just as long as it's creative and interesting. So if you were a storyteller or a troubadour or a bard in Europe, you'd be like, oh, the king, or depending on which king you're talking to, like, oh, the king is the greatest king, or you got to sing a song for the king. Or if you're a bard in, or what they call a griot in West Africa, you had to know every family's story. And the storyteller in that time period was really a social signifier, a reflection of that kind of thing. For us, I mean, I don't really get too much information from Fox TV. I don't know what story that's telling, but the stories, for me at least, are coming from the web right now. That's probably most of an interesting, weird, like YouTube imagination kind of. Some of the funniest things I've seen have been remixes of historical, you know, footage or, but yeah, that could be, it's just, you feel, personally at least, I feel this weird floating kind of feeling when I'm looking about our current digital, uncertain kind of, unstabilized. There's something very solid about when I was a kid, I saw Ronald Reagan on TV, and I was like, he's an actor. You know? You already can guess he's just gone. Like, there's no, like, it's theater, you know, he's just doing a role. But over the course of the last century or so, I think we've gotten more and more into this idea of culture is a story, like, you know, and we're just actors in a certain stage, and we just make the script up or something. I don't know. Anyways. That's my thought for the day.
So, Lawrence Lessig has been doing a talk for a long time, and a couple of versions that I've seen of it have him basically showing a lot of remixes and then saying, this is a new form of literacy, and that this will define literacy in the next century. So what you're doing as the literacy that will be required for leadership, for control. So, I kind of wonder what you thought of that. The literate set the tone and set the direction. So when is that going to happen? Is that happening? What role do teachers have to teach people that kind of literacy?
Yeah, I mean, it's a good point. You're looking at essentially what amounts to oral culture. because oral culture was usually about improvisation, coming up with new terms to define situations, exchange of terms, you know, slang. But now it's become a code, you know, or a video of slang, or you have certain styles of editing processes that are essentially a vernacular. And so people have visual literacy in a way that, you know, it's an attention deficit disorder on a huge scale. But at the same time, that is, I totally agree with Larry. Lessig, he actually blurted that in my book. But the whole pun here is, okay, literacy implies text. But if we're all reading from radically different and radically fractured and fragmented texts, what makes the meta-narrative? And that means, essentially, it's like a post-human narrative where we're talking with machines. Or there's a lot of times when you dial a number like 1-800, whatever, you know, you get like, hello, this is Rani Dasgupta. You know, you're calling, like, you thought you were calling like 1-800-Hertz for the car or something. But a lot of times nowadays, you just press whatever and you realize you're talking to a software and you don't know. It's like your credit card statement or something. But the pun here is that that's what the uncanny was about, the unheimlich that Sigmund Freud and all that kind of early guys were talking about, where you're at the edge of the human imagination. I don't think, personally, I think technology's moved faster than most of us have really been able to absorb. So that's where you get this uneasy sense of, like, why are we doing this? You know, and then you realize, well, the machines are just going and things are going. I kind of like the first Matrix, actually. But even though they had to go to Zion, which I don't know, I have weird problems with that. But I like to think of Zion as a reggae song or, you know, something. But the pun here is like how people respond to the social environment, which is conditioned by digital media at this point, if you're in the industrialized world. And we're not sure. I mean, most people barely know how their toilet works, let alone, you know, the computers or the software driving everything. So it's, you're looking at a vast sense of belief. You know, in the Middle Ages, if you walked in a room and the light came on, you'd think an angel had lit it. You know, but if you were to ask most people, how did that light come on, and the principles of electricity and magnetic flux and the light switch and the gases in the light bulb, most people are like, I don't know, you know, it just works. But that's the way, barring a very small group of people who actually know how the whole planet's running, maybe, or the electricity grid or the satellite frequencies that give you GPS signal, most people don't know how all this is going. I mean, you just get in your car and you turn on the engine and it works. But your car is mainly a computer now. I mean, what happens when your car gets a virus or something? I don't know. Yes, just now. It feels very science fictional at the moment. I don't know.
Other questions?
Way
back here.
Thank you very much. I really enjoyed your talk and performance today. To this last point, I had a question about, you were speaking about the democratization of information, in particular with technology, and how this is an intervention in the public and public sphere. But a lot of this intervention is taking place in the virtual world. And I'm wondering if there's a tension or a disconnect between these great ideas that create kind of publicities in the virtual world, but we then need to, it's our responsibility to then take them out into the real world so they have real effects. I mean, you just mentioned people in the industrialized world talking about light bulbs, talking about internet technologies. But what about people who don't have that?
That's a great question. I mean, some people respond to this idea of the digital divide, for example, which is the whole idea of class and structure scripted into how people use technology. The interesting thing is, in the third world, a lot of people are skipping the whole idea of the phone line and going straight to cell phones, pagers, beepers, and stuff like that. And so their social networks are actually ahead of a lot of America right now. A lot of America barely knows how to use text message or something weird stuff like that. I'll just give you a little story and then answer the second part. I was in Angola earlier last year, and they just ended a 25-year tribal civil war. You know, our tax dollars at work. And one of the things that was all the rage was these new text message parties, where kids would say that there's a sound system going on, and you know, you're in an African market, and you see a whole bunch of young kids with small, like, little cheap cell phones, probably made in China or bootlegged in Malaysia or something. And the kids are exchanging information. And then I go to some place like Tokyo, which is like mega hardcore high tech. There's wireless networks everywhere. Or Seoul, Korea, for example. I was in Seoul for most of September, and for
them, they're now having these weird cell phone film festivals, where, because they have such high bandwidth that they can watch a movie on their phone. And, so I watch people just gather around watching movies on the phone, which America, we won't get to that for a while. But the idea of democratization, not only of taste, but also of intervening in the public space. The metaphor for me is like when you look at the late 70s, when a lot of kids were tagging the trains in New York and Chicago and all the main cities, the idea was to go all city and have their tag enough spread throughout the city that everybody would recognize their new tag. And that was essentially a personal logo. So your tag evolved and people had to have literacy in reading that. So a lot of the graffiti kids, to show how they had skills, would really come up with a very elaborate and really amazingly scripted bits and pieces on the train. Meanwhile, the government hated it. And in New York alone spent over, I think, $100 million to erase all the trains. But nowadays you'd see that as an advertisement. So when you go on the train in New York, they have the same ads on every train everywhere. Or if you look at buses now, they're drenched with this kind of, it looks like graffiti, but it's like an ad for, I don't know, for like Doritos or something. So advertising and pride, you know, appropriated the same strategy, visual public space, but with the, you know, idea of commerce. So you're seeing there's always an arms race in public space, and that means whose expression gets heard and whose doesn't. And the underground, which is the world I'm coming out of and thinking about, you know, there's a very famous, I'm sure most of you guys have read Dostoevsky's Notes from Underground. But what is happening is the underground conditions global culture somehow. I'm not sure how, and this is something I've been traveling around a lot and just seeing just how people respond to information. But the underground is unregulated and things bubble up because they reach a certain threshold. And I'm not quite sure what that threshold is. But there's a reason why all of a sudden 2 years ago Danger Mouse's thing became popular, or there was a reason that early hip hop mixtapes were so popular, or there was a reason that people so wholeheartedly embraced the 8-track. it's a technology mirrors desires. And I think you have to always keep in mind desire is a very powerful force in human commerce. Adam Smith's The Invisible Hand, for example, that was all about massive economics, globalization, but in the 18th century. For us, The Invisible Hand is now wireless networks, Wi-Fi, downloadable scripts that you can put as widgets or, Wikipedia entries and so on. But it's still, the internet now is driving commerce, it's driving people's formation of identity. If you go outside of that, it's almost like you've detuned and plugged into a different time period or something. I've not been anywhere yet where I didn't see a cell phone, for example. Even like a rainforest in Brazil when I was going to visit Iguazu, which is this beautiful area, really, really remote. Yeah, a 12-year-old kid at the airport sitting on a cell phone, and that's changing, and I think you're going to see a much more critique of the digital divide as we go. But is that good? Is it bad? There's always people making money off of something. There's always a commercial impetus to why these kinds of things evolve. I don't know anymore. Right now, it just seems like the whole corporate culture has colonized so many things that even the idea of freedom, I remember the Haida-Iraq early stuff when Bush, they wanted, the French said no to the war, so they wanted to change the name from French fries to Freedom Fries or something. And I was like, that is so dumb. But just by trying to change the term, and come up with a new slang, it showed they had no roots in how language works. If it was really going to change, people would already come up with a new slang or something, or that would have been an underground development, not an overground. But little things like that. It's a very complex question to answer, because I'm a firm believer in the idea that people have agency, people can engage and change, but time and time again, there's a coup d'etat, a revolution, a massive change in a culture, and it's usually, some evil group takes over and causes misery for everyone. But 21st century, the things seem kind of either locked down in a weird way or very wide open, it's hard to kind of balance. This could be a longer discussion, but basically it seems like there's a kind of an eerie totalitarian framework of we're free, but of, well, how free is free? As I said, Animal Farm.
I'd like to get a little bit of the question. I think that you can't make the mistake of assuming that technology will determine the destination of human existence. At least I can't, as
artists. I think in the long run, the expression of what we do as individuals and the use of technologies, the combination of those two things. Now, if you look at the history of civilization, we have been moving towards little people. In other words, there was one time in art that you painted kings, then you painted nobility, then you painted workers, then you painted poor people. And I think that movement is really hitting off on the 21st century, that if you go to see a show in photography, most of it are little people that express the desire to have and are able to exist on very little. So I think that encompassing condition of humankind will actually in the long run win out, and of course it will win out mainly because artists like you have synthesized this and that expression of humaneness or whatever it is in all of us as people will actually win in terms of saving the globe. I don't put any trust in technology saving the globe whatsoever because technology is eventually controlled. So that it's anti-human experience and it's actually those that own the medium control its expression, but they don't totally own the medium. And I think it's this underground, that's the word that you used, and it's the underground expression that enables us to think, enables us to compare, and enables us to make choices.
I know we got to close. Maybe one last question, somebody in the back.
Any questions?
Do you want to just yell it out? Or?
Right here.
It's good, but I'm thinking, in a way, is it, would you research the most people who do it, they don't? So, when people start, you said earlier about people making the same mistakes over and over again. I guess, I had in my head, I should have wrote it down. is there some type of danger in a way that people are mimicking things to the point that what's the real sense? It becomes, when you talk about a copy of a copy of a copy, the true original message becomes lost in a way. Okay, in the beginning, when you showed your family was sitting there, it was with the dirt and very natural. And now everything is very much, people are moving away from that. People are doing everything, it's technology, technology, technology. But the truth of the matter is, he said the reality of it is that right now we need water. Right now we're lacking certain natural resources. It's because we're going too much to tech. If the technology is used correctly, then I can see the benefit of it repeating, repeating, repeating. If you're going to repeat something like peace, 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 or love, whatever it is to generate, or if you're going to use it to reiterate or to better Earth, I can see that. But when somebody takes something, just make it for a month, for the money or for the math, for everyone, I see what you're doing. I think the way you connect things is genius. But most people don't connect like that. They just do it for the materialism, the materialism of it, and not for the value of how it's going to improve people. So, Pilates, because everything starts going natural, but then it goes to something that's, totally unnatural.
that's a hard question. I don't want to be viewed as supporting just technology is great, everybody be technology. In fact, it's almost like I have a very uneasy relationship to technology. And I definitely feel that, that we're in a very twisted time in terms of the environment, in terms of how, materials that we use, everything from your computer to your shoes are made of pretty much toxic materials. The atmosphere is all messed up. I actually went down to Antarctica in December to shoot a film. And
you know, there's like huge pieces of ice breaking off there. You know, it's definitely very heavy, strange times. All these storms and weird weather patterns, species, you know, becoming extinct very quick. You know, this. I do think that artists should tell people another world is possible. I don't know if that's because we're going to provide the map or blueprint. You know, I don't know if that's my role. But at least getting people to think that another way, another part of, you know, thinking or getting, just beginning to realize, you know, that there's another way that you can do something or think about something, that often is a big start. Because most people are like, why do I need to do anything different? I just, you know, and you'd be surprised. We have that kind of inertia on a lot of levels. And that's why things just keep going. You could wake up in the morning and say, I don't want to do X, Y, and Z, and just not do it anymore. But people, you know, they do it because they've been conditioned, and we have that kind of mechanistic response a lot of times. So this is the last question. I know we've been saying for time here, but basic vibe is, I like to think of my work as saying another world is possible. Not quite sure which world yet, but at the end of the day, it's just trying to get people to think about some stuff from different angles, and to not, to not take everything for granted so much. And I like and celebrate complexity, and nobody's going to answer you all questions everywhere. So a lot of that means people have to search for themselves, you know, just figure. By the way, if you liked a lot of the video clips, I have stuff on my website, chbookie.com. Tomorrow night is the show. I'm not going to get all political on everybody. It's just a look at the old South of the soul music scene. I got a lot of records from Stax Records. It's definitely a classic Memphis soul music. Everybody from Isaac Hayes, Aretha Franklin, the Staple Singers, Sam and Dave, Otis Redding, all those guys came out of Stax Records. So tomorrow night, and I guess, do you want to have any comments or wrap up?
Thank you all for coming. Do get to see the show tomorrow, as Paul's told you. The merch is in the back, because you need books too. You can still be literate. You don't just have to hear it. You've all got music to pass along. I hope you'll pass it along. Don't forget to pass stickers with it, and don't hoard them. Because if you did not get CDs, or a couple more up here, or you can make friends with the person beside you and they can burn you one. Either way, I want to thank all our sponsors for you guys being here. We'll see you with other events. I'm curious about one thing. How many people signed up on the Facebook event as yes? How many people signed up as maybe? Facebook maybes are not real.